Hello, hello, happy Wednesday, and welcome to Wellness Wednesday Inspiration. My name is Fernanda. I'm with Dr. Linda, my amazing co-host, and we have a guest today, Dr. Felice Gersh, coming back for, I believe, to be the third or fourth time on this show. We just love having her around, and today she's going to be showing her and talking to us about her expertise in women's health and more precisely menopause. So the topic for today is how menopause affects your health and what you can do about it. So if you know anyone who can relate to this topic, if you yourself can relate to this topic, please connect with us. Please be active in the chat. Ask any questions for Dr. Felice. We're going to be talking about her new book that just came out. We're going to be sharing that in a little bit. And also make sure that you share and invite anybody else that can benefit from these conversation today. With that, I want to welcome you, Dr. Linda, as well. How are you doing today?
Hi, I'm doing great. Wednesday. I'm just like, my days are all confused right now with the holidays and everything. And it's been a little bit crazy. And happy belated birthday, because you just celebrated a birthday. I'm not even going to ask you how old you are, because I know you're just young. So, but I know you had, you've been really busy with a lot going on. And I'm just glad that we can still just stay committed and, you know, being here every single week. So, you know, thank you for that, and always just enjoy our time. And yes, we have Dr. Felice Gersh back. I just love her, love her, love her. I mean, she's a colleague, she's a friend, she's, you know, my personal doc. So highly, highly recommend her. And I know we have people from all over. And the beauty of telemedicine now is that a lot of people can get, especially women, can get care from a woman who understands, because a lot of times women will go to a male doctor and they're just say, oh, suck it up. You know, it's just like, you're going through menopause, you're going through this, you're going through hormonal changes, suck it up, you know, take this. But they don't really take the time to explain so that you can understand that you're not losing your mind. So that's what I love about, you know, Dr. Felice, is that, you know, she's very, she's passionate about what she does. She's a very compassionate individual. I mean, her knowledge is just beyond what I can even explain in this short time that we have. But I mean, she's one of the top notch doctors in Orange County, and has been nominated by her peers as being one of the best doctors in Orange County. And I think she's one of the top women in the field when it comes to women's health, that, and she's the go-to. Her name is going to pop up in that conversation. So I'm just so grateful that she's on the show here with us today. And I'm going to let her do a little bit more of introducing her. I mean, she's been in practice for definitely over 20 years, and she's got an integrative practice. So that's what I really love about her, because she gets the best from, you know, natural medicine and using pharmacology and blending them together, but looking at the individual as a whole. She's also an author, very, you know, she's a sought out speaker, and I want her to share about one of her new books. She's, like I said, best-selling author. She's got this one, and it's an awesome resource here. So why don't we bring Dr. Felice on, and just so excited to have her back.
Hi, I'm so excited to be here.
Welcome back.
When three women get together, it's just like, you never know where the conversation's going, right?
Right.
And that's what I love about having you on, because you really just, the way you just explain what's going on with a woman's body, it's not so overwhelming, because it can be for some women, and they don't feel comfortable going and asking questions to their doctor, because they feel a lot of times that they talk down to them and not to them. And that's one of the biggest complaints that I see in the practice.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I try to look on a macro scale. I mean, I say I'm not smart enough to micromanage every cell in a person's body. So I like to take it sort of like from the 20,000 foot view, looking down on what can we do as a whole to allow each cell to make its own decision so it can get what it needs to do all the right things. And so it's sort of like a basic way of looking at the body. You give it what it needs and it will do what it's supposed to do. And that's where menopause really comes into play, is that hormones are really like the communication system of the body. They It delivers information that tells the cell what to do. So if you don't have those hormones in the right amounts, at the right time, in the right rhythm, then the cells are like, I don't know what to do. And of course, if you throw in endocrine disruptors, then you get the wrong instructions. So it's really a challenge as we age. We get either the wrong information to the cells delivered, or we get no information. And so I just try to put it all together so that given the reality that we live in, you know, we can't change everything, but we can really work hard to optimize all our opportunities to have healthy longevity.
Can you tell us, the audience, what are endocrine disruptors? Some people don't know what that is.
Absolutely. These are the chemicals that are surrounding us that have an effect on our hormones. So the effects can be many different types of effects. It could be concerning the production of hormones, the distribution, the elimination, the detoxification. So it can be affecting how the receptors are interacting with the hormones. So it's on any of one of many different levels that these chemicals can interfere with the normal function of our hormones with very grave effects. And these types of chemicals are very great in terms of their different types and numbers. So it includes all the different types of plastics, the BPA, the BPS, the BPF, the phthalates, and then flame retardants and solvents of all kinds, heavy metals. So there's so many different chemicals that seem to interfere with the different hormones. And of course, the key hormone that's interfered with is estrogen. And we call those chemicals xenoestrogens. They're chemicals that can do all kinds of different crazy things involving the way our estrogens in our body should work. And it can lead to a lot of metabolic and reproductive dysfunctions. So we need to be really well aware of all this. So we make smart choices, like don't take food out. If you do take food out, of course, sometimes we do, make sure you immediately transfer it to something stainless steel or glass or ceramic so that it's not sitting in the you know, the food takeout containers. Try not to drink hot food from plastic, you know, types of things, and try to use glass, stainless steel, ceramic, and such as much as we can for storing food. And look at the kinds of cookware that you use, the cleaning solutions and so on. So it's a big job to try to reduce, we can never eliminate, but reduce the exposure to these ubiquitous endocrine disruptors.
And Dr. Phyllis, your book is specifically on menopause and 50 things you need to know. And I don't think that we have enough time for 50. But I would like to maybe for you to maybe start by explaining a little bit more about menopause. I feel like a lot of people think of menopause as simply when they don't get their menses anymore, their period. Right. So I'm menopause because I'm not bleeding anymore, and that's it. I'm menopausal. But I think there is way more to it than just not getting their period or our period every month to menopause. Can you explain a little bit more about what it means and what's happening in our bodies as we approach menopause and as we go through menopause?
Well, absolutely. The first thing to understand is the word menopause was chosen because it does talk about like an endpoint. So by definition, the word menopause comes into play if you have 12 consecutive months without a spontaneous period. Now, that's a very arbitrary, made-up definition, and it's not really telling the story. So I wish I could change the name, but nothing is ever going to change with the name. So we have to try to work on understanding what it really means. So that's what we're going to talk about. Mm-hmm. It's really about ovarian aging. And one of the things that happens as the ovaries age is that they're going to produce hormones in a different and lesser amount. You're not going to ovulate. You're not going to get that spike of estradiol. And then if you don't ovulate, you're not going to make progesterone. So the first thing that is going to go is reduced amounts of estrogen in the form of estradiol. That's the estrogen the ovaries makes. And then you're going to stop making progesterone if you stop ovulating. And if you don't make progesterone, you're not going to have a period. So if you don't ovulate for 12 consecutive months, you're not going to have any periods. And then that will be officially, you're labeled as menopause. But that is part of the process. So we have to rethink menopause instead of as like you're crossing a finish line and you've arrived. It's a journey. Okay. And there's we never know the exact moment when every egg is gone, because it's going to happen after you actually stop having periods, because the eggs can just sort of be there. They're making some estrogen, but they're not ovulating. So the bottom line is, think of it as sort of a parallel to declining fertility. And every woman knows that when she gets over 35 and certainly into her 40s, her fertility is declining. And that's reflecting a decline in egg number, egg quality, ovulation, and so on, and the ability to make viable embryos. So it's all in tandem together. And so we should think of it as a process. And it's not like a process that comes without consequences. Mm-hmm. I wish it could just be, well, everything's exactly the same, except now you don't have periods. But it isn't the same, because those hormones that we're no longer producing in the right amount, and then not at all, then we are eventually, our ovaries will completely stop making any estrogen and any progesterone completely. And when that happens, it has, and during the process, there are huge reproductions throughout the body, because these hormones are not just about fertility. And that's such an important takeaway. They're about sustaining every body function for the purpose of having successful fertility and reproduction. So the body is one coordinated whole, and you would never expect that, you know, everything is disconnected. We know that in integrative, holistic types of medicine approach, that it's one body and all the organ systems work in a coordinated fashion. And if you look at reproduction as really a prime purpose of life in general, then you're going to have all the systems of the body, the GI tract, the neurological systems, the musculoskeletal systems, the cardiovascular systems, all interconnected to support successful reproduction. And those hormones, estrogen and progesterone, and I put estrogen is sort of at the peak, sort of like, you know, the prime, like if you're looking at, you know, like Batman and Robin. So it's like the Batman, and then progesterone is like the Robin, but they need each other. They go together. And when you lose those vital hormones, they're not just about reproduction. They're about every organ system. And that's really what I wanted to drive home, that the repercussions of losing these vital hormones are system-wide, organ-wide. And that's why we need to really understand menopause, not to stop it. We can't stop it. It's like totally inevitable for every female. There is no escape from going through menopause. If you eat a supremely healthy diet, with lots of polyphenols and antioxidants and fiber and so on, and you have good genes that you're lucky to be born with, you may delay menopause by a couple of years, but that's it. It's coming for you. And we need to be ready for it. So that's why we need to understand the process. That's why in my book, I talk about the three stages of menopause. So we stop thinking of it as you are one day not in menopause and the next day you are. It's not that at all. It's a process, and it's really something that every woman needs to understand and prepare for. You know, it's like everything. We always talk in California here where I live, earthquake preparedness. Now it should be everywhere that you live. It's preparedness for something, right? So we females have to have menopause preparedness and understand what's coming, the significance, and then really, hopefully, have pragmatic and really effective ways to deal with it.
Mm-hmm. And I love how you explain it. I think maybe you should write a book on and kind of connect it with the superheroes of menopause. You were saying Batman and Robin. I'm like, I like that analogy. You know, Batman's like the star, like, you know, like estradiol, but, you know, Robin is progesterone. You still need them. And it's like, okay, then who's cortisol and who's testosterone? Have all the superhero stories.
That's right. In
that way. That would be a cool way to write it.
I love it. Oh, that's a great idea. You said you put women together, you never know where it's going.
There you go.
Oh, that's awesome. One question that really, like you were saying, there's women usually in their like 30s, 40s, they're almost like perimenopausal because they're not at menopause, and fertility, you know, it decreases as well. And there's a lot of women that seem to have more of an issue when they're in perimenopause and they're still having cycles, just now their estrogen and progesterone levels are really taking a big dip. I mean, I see that a lot, and it's just like, it feels like they're going crazy, like their body's breaking down. Can you hit a little bit upon that? Like, you know, how do you kind of approach that to, because they think I'm in perimenopause now, and that could last a long, long time. And it could last for some women 10 years, right? Mm-hmm. And then once they get into menopause, it's just like, oh my gosh. But sometimes peri is more intense than actually being in menopause.
It is for many women, because what's happening is during this, like we'll say prelude to menopause, which is like the transition and perimenopause. Mm-hmm. And because menopause by definition in the United States occurs and is considered normal between 45 and 55. So if you're later than 55, then that would be a very late menopause. And if you're before, then it would be considered an early menopause. And there's some negatives in having an early menopause in particular. So that's a big range right there. So there are some women, if you figure that the sort of the scaling down, instead of calling it scaling up for going into menopause, for some women who hit menopause at 45, that means you're right. At 35, they're already noticing things are changing. And that's a very big deal. And other women, they may be a decade later. So we need to understand that as the ovaries are aging, so we call it like ovarian senescence, they become more unpredictable in their ovulation and the estrogen and progesterone levels that are produced. So the brain is the great sensor in the body for sensing, well, what is happening? You know, it senses nutrients, it senses light and dark, and it senses hormones. So if you're not making enough estrogen, for example, according to the brain's perception of it, it puts out a signal through the hypothalamus to the pituitary gland, which then makes hormones called gonadotropins, which are then going to travel in the bloodstream to the ovary, and they trigger the ovary to make more hormones and to ovulate. So, and then the precursor to estradiol in the ovary is testosterone. So the way that you make estrogen from the ovary is it's like a little assembly line going down the line. First you make testosterone, and then if the testosterone moves to a different part of the ovary, and there it's converted into estradiol. So the brain, when you don't have enough estradiol, that's the estrogen from the ovary, it puts out more signals, and the pituitary puts out its signals, and you have a rise in LH, luteinizing hormone, and FSH, follicle stimulating hormone. And so initially, when you make more LH, you're going to make more testosterone. So for some women, they say, like, they could be in their late 30s or early 40s, and they say, what is this? Am I a teenager again? What's happening to me? Like, they're suddenly getting some facial hair, they're getting acne, and they don't feel right. They're getting some gut issues, they're having some emotional lability, their things are changing. And it's because suddenly their testosterone can actually go up, you know, suddenly, because they're not actually converting it as well to the estrogen at that point. And also their brain is saying, well, we want more. And that means more precursor. And then sometimes in the beginning, the first decade preceding menopause, their ovaries are not dead. They're not done. They're just like failing, we'll say, but they still have some capabilities. And if they're stimulated hard enough by the luteinizing hormone, the follicle stimulating hormone, they will actually sometimes have a surge of estrogen production. So suddenly you get this gigantic surge. So it goes too low. And then you get, whoa, this like a blast of estrogen comes out. And that can give migraines. So often it's what triggers migraines is fluctuating hormone levels, which of course, fortunately, that's, if you can look at the bright side, you have to always look at the bright side. After menopause, there's no fluctuation because it's like zero. But, you know, during the perimenopause, it's like a roller coaster. You can have too little, then you have too much, then you have too little. And what that can create, all kinds of breast tenderness and mood swings and sleep problems, hot flashes and night sweats, but they can come and go. So they think, what am I, crazy? And then that also can give you cognitive dysfunction. So they now have published studies showing that the majority of women will have like a brain fog problem because their hormone levels in their brains are fluctuating so much. And then they get, like I mentioned, like people who are prone to migraines, sometimes people who never even had migraines before will be triggered to have migraines. And breast tenderness and breast cysts can really just go through the roof for some women. And then because hormones are related to everything, they may then have dysfunction with their gut, because the hormones actually have a lot to do with the composition of the gut microbiome. So they'll have shifting gut microbial populations. And so we have many things that are fluctuating. These fluctuations can be very significant. And then we have women with declining fertility because they're getting older, but because they still have some viable eggs, they're not done. They're just in the process of ending, but they're still there working. They have the highest rate of developing twins because they can have such a surge of these hormones coming from the pituitary, trying to get the ovaries to make more estrogen as a response to low estrogen, because it's like this swinging up and down, that they can then ovulate two eggs at once. And then suddenly they didn't have a period for 3 months. Suddenly they ovulate with two eggs coming out. And the next thing, no, they thought, oh, I can't get pregnant. And the next thing you know, they're pregnant with twins.
Oh, so my gosh. It's
like, so these are very interesting, like say, we'll say very interesting years when fertility is declining, but it's not gone. And they can get twins and they have crazy fluctuations of hormones, which can make them seem literally like they're going in and out of menopause because their hormones are too low, then it's too high, then it's too low. And so it is definitely a challenge. And there's so many symptoms that can be quite surprising for women that they're experiencing during those years. So the first thing is to know what to expect, and then you won't be shocked. And then the next thing is to, you know, have a few tools so that you can deal with it.
You share with us so many different possible changes that we can experience, from mood changes all the way up to like skin changes, hair changes, migraines, all kinds of things. So it really can affect and women can experience perimenopause through so many different changes. So it's very important to always stay connected and see, you know, what's changing and is it different than it was before, right? Because sometimes, like Dr. Linda mentioned, sometimes perimenopause can be even more intense than menopause, but sometimes it can also be subtle. And so it's very important to stay connected and see what changes experiencing with our bodies. And we do have a question with from an audience member, but I do want to ask you, Dr. Feliz, just going back to the perimenopause for a second, when do women normally experience perimenopause? At what age?
So it would vary between 35 and up to 50. So in general, could be, that's a big range of years.
Yeah.
And some women will have symptoms for 10 years, some will be 4 years. I mean, so it's very, very variable. And you're so right. I'm glad that you mentioned it. In the earlier points, you know, like in the perimenopause, when the symptoms are so blatant, I mean, women are going to notice them. And they notice things that are so disturbing. Like they look at them and themselves in the mirror and they say, excuse my, but what's happening to my face? You know, like they find like their lips are thinning and they're seeing, you know, the nasal labial folds and wrinkles around their eyes that they didn't have before. And it's like, you know, like they'll think like, I'm only 42. Like, why do I look so, and I look at a picture of myself when I was like 33 and I look so much older to myself when I look in the mirror. Or they get on the scale and they say, what is happening? You know, and then they try to put on their clothes and it's like, wait a minute, my waistline is so much bigger. And like, what's this muffin top? Where did this come from? You know, so, you know, because their metabolism is changing. And these things are so distressing for so many women that, you know, that their skin is wrinkling, their lips are thinning, they're not sleeping as well. They have night sweats coming and going. So these are so blatantly obvious during the perimenopause. But there are so many things like in the later menopause, like after you've been out in menopause for 10 years, you may have things that are happening that are completely invisible, you know, unless you are getting proper healthcare. Like you may develop high blood pressure, like by age 65, you know, about 65, 70% of women have high blood pressure. By age 75, 85% of women have high blood pressure. Women have more strokes more ruptured aneurysms than men. They die from cardiovascular disease more than any other cause. And they're losing bone that is silently lost. And then hip fractures are so prevalent, spinal fractures. And over 50% of women will end up with what can be a life-changing, even sometimes life-ending fracture. And these are things like with their cardiovascular system, even cognitive changes that are not so obvious, like, you know, when they have brain fog, things that can lead and increase the risk of Alzheimer's. Like, for example, between 2 and 3 times the incidence of Alzheimer's in women compared to men. And we don't talk about that. And, you know, 80% of osteoporotic fractures are in women. The majority of joint replacements are in women. And breast cancer, which of course is on every woman's mind, is significantly higher after menopause than before menopause. So, but these things happen silently. So, you know, we have these different stages of menopause, and we need to recognize both the obvious symptoms and also be aware of the things that are happening silently that can have tremendous health consequences. So it's a complex, transition through all these different phases.
And I'm glad that you've written about this too, because what's interesting, if we look at this from the bigger scale, there's really only a short time of fertility. And most of the other time it's where we're not in bleed. There's only a short time, right? When you're having your menses, and the majority time of your life, you're in a menopausal state. So, and it's not really addressed. I think it's kind of overlooked and kind of brushed aside, like, you're of no use to us anymore, so we're not going to focus on you.
I know.
And it's just really sad, because, but there's a lot of women that do thrive, can still thrive in their life. And yes, and what you were talking about, like, oh my gosh, cardiovascular, you know, propensity for cardiovascular issues, you know, for brain, breath health declines, you know, bone health declines. But there are active strategies that women can actually do. And I know, Fernanda, you were going to address one of the questions. We have a couple questions from here if you want to ask Dr. Gersh.
We have a couple of questions. So here's the first one, if you can see it up in the screen. What type of estrogen do you use for menopausal women? Do you give also progesterone? What dosage do you think it's safe to start the replacement? And how do you monitor the patient?
Well, that is basically the foundation for every kind of hormone therapy, and which is, of course, so key, because it's not just giving hormones, it's giving the right type and in the right dose and in the right way and everything. So we know now without any doubt that the only way to safely give estrogen is really in the form of estradiol, which is the same form that the ovaries make estrogen, and to give it through the skin. So we call that transdermal. If you take it as a pill, which is nice and convenient, unfortunately, when you take it as a pill, it gets digested and it's converted to a different form. And it goes into the bloodstream as predominantly estrone. Even if you swallow estradiol, when it gets into your blood, it's estrone. And estradiol binds appropriately to all the different estrogen receptors, which creates that metabolic calmness and equilibrium within the body that we call homeostasis. But if you have only one type of estrogen, estrone, that binds predominantly to only one type of estrogen receptor, which creates a very imbalanced situation. And it increases significantly the risk, for example, of having blood clots, which is, of course, very bad. We do not want to have our blood clotting in our blood vessels. So we don't want to take oral estrogen. And progesterone is not optional, even for women who have a hysterectomy. That's because, unfortunately, the conventional GYN world doesn't see the total body of the woman and all the different receptors that exist for progesterone throughout the body. For example, just in the brain, progesterone is neuroprotective. So we and it balances out with the immune system. So it has, and it works in the gut. It basically, if you think of the Chinese yin yang kind of a thing, which is like this wonderful balance, push pull and so on, the progesterone and the estrogen, they work together, just, you know, in a beautiful team effect. So you can't have one without the other and then have optimal function of the body. So we have to give progesterone, even though by giving progesterone the way that it's optimally to be given, which is to mimic a menstrual cycle. Now, progesterone in a functioning reproductive aged woman is not produced by the ovaries all month long. It's produced only for the 2 weeks following ovulation. And that actually creates a different dynamic in the body because it actually works as sort of a counterpoint to the estrogen, like sort of like the break. So progesterone actually down-regulates or makes it less functional, the receptors for estrogen. So it's kind of like the breaks. But so if you give progesterone and estrogen at the same time, all the time, it's like you're driving a car, you don't have on the parking brake, and you're pressing on the gas pedal and you're pressing on the brake pedal at the same time, trying very hard to push them both down and keep the car from moving. Because basically the reason that that idea came about, that you would give progesterone and estrogen together, the same dose every single day, was to try to keep the uterine lining from growing and then shedding, creating bleeding, right? Because the idea was no woman after menopause will put up with having so-called periods. Of course, they're not real periods, but it would be real blood, you know, and they don't want to have that. And they just simply won't do that. And that's true. There are some women, they say that's a deal breaker. But I try to explain that unfortunately, or fortunately, how you frame, everything is how you frame it, right? This is how our bodies were designed. And if you think of it as that you can't really drive a car with the brakes and the gas on at the same time, exactly, that's like crazy. So if you try to prevent estrogen from doing its job by counteracting it with progesterone all the time, you're not just affecting the effect of estrogen in the uterine lining, it's the same thing everywhere. You're going to be countering all the beneficial effects, or at least to some degree, the beneficial effects of estrogen in the other parts of the body. And there's actually some published literature, of course, never enough, because there's never enough studies on women, that show better protection against both breast cancer and cardiovascular disease if you give the progesterone 2 weeks out of every month and not every single day. And progesterone is classically given as a pill, but some people can't tolerate it as a pill because it does get metabolized into certain byproducts or metabolites that for some people makes them feel too sleepy. And that's why you take it at night. Mm-hmm. So for some women, we do give progesterone cream, but there's also less data on that. But it can be a viable option when the progesterone pills just don't agree, because there's nothing that agrees with everybody. And as far as the dosing of the estrogen, it's given through the skin. So it can be given as a commercial bioidentical product, which would be like an estrogen patch or a gel. And there are a couple of different brands that make gels, or it can be made through a compounding pharmacy where it's typically placed into a cream and the dosing can be very individualized. And then the cream can be applied to different places in the body, depending on that individual woman's ability to absorb it and distribute it through her body in the best way. And that's where you really have to accept that what we're doing when we give hormones after menopause is totally concocted. Okay. Nature never expected us to actually try to prolong the wonderful effects of these hormones, because it's linked so much to reproduction. And when it's like what you started in the beginning saying, like, well, you know, when you're done, you know, so, but you know, nature may have hung us up to dry, even though I love nature, but nature is both beautiful and wise, but can be cruel. Remember, it's the same nature that gives us beautiful sunny days and tornadoes and such, you know? Yeah. So that's all the same thing from nature. And nature can't have every creature on earth be immortal. There's limited resources. So nature is thinking about sort of survival of the species. And once you're no longer reproducting, you know, a reproductive creature, you know, you're sort of like essentialness on the planet is like less, but we still get to live, which is nice. So if we're going to keep living, we might as well live optimally, right? Why would we want to live with disability and such? So it's a trickery thing. I understand, and I'm totally honest, giving hormones after menopause, there's nothing natural about it, but I don't like the natural effects of menopause. I'm just like, and we, everything in medicine is designed to counter something we don't like. So instead of having women have to have cataracts replaced or joints replaced or be on a multitude of pharmaceuticals for a host of problems or dealing with fractures and disability and dementia, instead of having all of those things happen, which are natural, we want to intervene maybe in a natural but unnatural way, giving natural hormones to try to be physiologic, like kind of replacing hormones in a way that the body was designed to have them. And then recognizing that every cell in your body doesn't know what age you are. So it's not like any cell says, oh, well, you're too old. I'm not going to respond to this hormone. That's not how it works. If every cell in your body is a different age anyway, some of them were just made yesterday, right? They were replacing a different cell. So different cells in your body are different ages, and they're all genetically programmed in a certain way to respond if you give them the right nutrients, if you give them the circadian rhythm that they need, because they all have clock genes, if you give them the right hormones, they'll still behave as if you were 25. Now, realistically, we can't quite do that. We can't give you hormones that are going to be the same like when you're 25 and have perfectly functioning ovaries, but we try our best. We do better than nothing, better than having no hormones. So we try to give the same environment, the same creations that the cells need so that they can actually do their job optimally. And that's really the goal of giving hormones. So we want to give doses that for that woman are going to mimic a functional healthy level. And it's going to be varied depending on the woman, because every woman is going to absorb hormones through her skin differently. You can give the same dose to 10 women and different levels will be in her. Because the skin was not designed as a hormone delivery system. It was not designed for that. We're just so clever, we humans, that you know, we came up with this idea. So, but it can change the trajectory of a woman's life in her peri and postmenopausal years by having physiologic human bioidentical hormones put into her in this way that is so brilliant and can actually help every cell to keep functioning the way it was functioning when you were younger, so that your body will just stay healthier and optimally functioning for so much longer. And so that's sort of like in a nutshell, the basics of hormones. You know, every woman has to be individualized because we're not going to know the dose until we try it on her. And then we have to test levels because every woman is going to absorb the hormones differently. She's going to use them differently and eliminate them from her body differently. So we have to individualize it. And so it's definitely not cookie cutter at all. And every woman changes over time. So your skin is going to absorb hormones differently in the same dose. If we give it to you when you're 50 and we give it to you when you're 70, your skin is not going to be the same. So you may need a different dose when you're 70 and probably will. So it's very individualized, very personalized medicine when you're dealing with menopausal medicine.
And I think that kind of answers the questions. There's a couple of questions, you know, they were asking, how do you monitor the patient, which you just covered. Also, someone had mentioned about having high estradiol, low progesterone, cortisol levels are low. They had a partial hysterectomy. But once again, it really just, it's bioindividuality when it comes to working with hormones. And that's why a person really has to work with a very knowledgeable practitioner, because I've had patients come in and they're on, and I don't prescribe hormones, but they're on estradiol and I'm looking for progesterone. I'm like, are you not, why aren't you on progesterone? I'm like, well, I'm like, that just didn't make any sense to me. And so I'm glad that you, it's just Batman's here, but where's Robin?
Exactly. Exactly.
They came to the scene but only Batman's here.
And everything is going to work so much better. I mean, a lot of people don't realize that there are progesterone receptors in the skin. Your skin will look better and work better if you have progesterone. Your brain will work better. You will sleep better. So, and it works also as a diuretic. So they're very different. So like estrogen is more constipating, progesterone is more like a laxative, but you know, so that they work together, and progesterone helps as more like a diuretic. So you get rid of excessive fluid buildup. So they work together to help everything in the body work properly. They work on the immune system as well. Like estrogen can activate the immune system to fight off invading pathogens like viruses and bacteria. And progesterone also is involved and is more of a calming. It sort of calms down the immune response so that you don't have an over-the-top inflammatory response. So you definitely want to always have that beautiful balance, which is why I say if you're willing to have a period, if you take adequate amounts of estrogen, you will build up your uterine lining. And then if you take adequate amounts of progesterone, you will shed it. And that's like, think of it as a catharsis. And there's actually some studies showing in a woman who's cycling, a reproductive age woman, when she has her period, the lining cells of the uterus aren't the only things that are being sort of expelled from the body. They've actually shown that like senescence, like these old and sort of yucky cells in the breast are being destroyed. We call that programmed cell apoptosis, like programmed cell suicide. So crappy cells that you want them to kill themselves are actually triggered to kill themselves by having a menstrual cycle with a period. Mm-hmm. So think of it as sort of like the spring and, you know, renewal after like the dark winter of the cycle, and you get rid of the bad stuff, and then you reclaim the land, you reclaim your uterine lining, and you also create new cells. So it, and there's interesting data that when you have the estrogen and progesterone in the right balance, in the right amounts, you actually can trigger tumor suppressor genes that actually can suppress the development of, for example, breast cancer cells. So, I mean, these things, nature did not give us hormones and cycles to create cancer. It's, we have these amazing built-in protective mechanisms that we need to try to harness as best we can. And when we give hormones to a menopausal woman, you know, in full recognition that this is not what nature thought we were going to do. But then nature never thought of a lot of things that we're doing, right? I don't know about space travel. I don't know, you know, who thought of this like 25,000 years ago, right? But so, you know, we're just the most creative, innovative species that anything could, who could imagine what we've come up with. So the fact that we can come up with ways to have unbelievably healthy aging is like amazing. Why not take advantage of it?
Right. It's awesome.
And Dr. Felice, I kind of want to ask you kind of just to bring everything home. And the title of the show was What is Menopause and What Can You Do About It? So can you give us maybe the top three things that anyone listening can do to navigate perimenopause, menopause, and that stage in our lives in a much easier way? And you've been touching about it and you've been talking about it throughout the show, but what would be the top three things?
Okay, so I was thinking like, what do my patients come to me with and they complain about? And putting hormone therapy aside. So these are things that you can access on your own. So I would say that probably the biggest thing that people come up with initially would be things like poor sleep, hot flashes, night sweats. And that is occurring in about 80% of women as they are going through this transitional time. So there's some interesting studies that show that if you eat phytoestrogen foods, so that would be like whole organic soybeans, like edamame, if you get edamame, unless, you know, of course, some people are sensitive to different foods, but assuming that you can tolerate, as most people can, edamame. If you add a cup of edamame, organic soybeans, whole, you know, unprocessed, and you add a cup of that every day, there are studies showing that in just 12 weeks, almost 100% of women had like 90% elimination of that those symptoms of night sweats and hot flashes, which disrupts sleep and self-esteem, and then everything else goes down the tubes when you don't get a good night's sleep. I mean, that's like, I'm sure you've done plenty of talks about the importance of sleep. Mm-hmm. Well, night sweats are disruptive to sleep in huge, horrible ways. So just by changing the diet in that way, you can have that amazing benefit. Another one, probably one of the key things that people come in, I alluded to this, is weight gain. Now, the reason that women can gain weight is because estrogen runs the energy creation factories of the cell, the mitochondria. Without adequate estrogen, you literally don't have the ability to burn fat as well. I mean, and that's, of course, going to affect every organ system. In addition, estrogen controls adipose tissue deposition sites. So if you don't have, you know, like when you think of a girl going through puberty, she will do nothing, just go through puberty, and suddenly she gets breasts and she gets some fat on her butt and her hips, and she gets a girly figure, right? And a boy, she could have a fraternal twin who's a brother, and he doesn't look like her, you know, because he gets his testosterone. So these hormones are destiny for how we produce and then store our fat. So women have these really interesting places that we are supposed to store healthy fat, the subcutaneous fat. Well, after menopause, you don't burn fat well. You tend towards more insulin resistance, which then creates more inflammation and higher glucose levels, and that produces more fat. And our fat goes to the default places, which is visceral tissue and belly fat. So what can we do about it? So every woman should know that this is a natural but undesirable effect of going through the menopausal transition. Well, there are every lifestyle thing can help. Everything from, of course, exercise, which goes without saying, will help you to burn fat better. And now the biggest thing is time-restricted eating, where we don't want to snack during the day. We don't want to eat past 7 p.m. at night, earlier if possible. Have a 13-hour fast from dinner to breakfast, okay? So that is like really, really important. And by exercising regularly, and preferably if you can in the morning, they've shown that morning exercise will help with weight loss and maintaining a healthy weight better than afternoon, but I'll take any time of day that people will give me. And then by trying to eat more food in the first half of the day, either a big breakfast or then a big lunch and a very small dinner, and not snacking and getting that 13-hour fast at night, that this will have tremendous benefits for maintaining a healthy weight. And then probably the other areas that come up with are women who are trying to be proactive. And they're saying, okay, well, what do I do about my bones? Because bones have really gotten sort of a lot of press, right? Mm-hmm. Every other, and bones are really important. And bones also rely on having healthy muscle. So when people don't talk about muscle loss, which is sarcopenia, and what's not well recognized is that both bone and muscle are not just about locomotion and support, you know, so we can stand up and move, but they're actually also endocrine organs. And bone actually makes hormones that actually maintain glucose regulation and also make our brains work better. Loss of bone gives you more diabetes and dementia and mood problems. So bones are so important, but people don't even realize how important they are. But they know, because so many women have relatives, including myself, who've had serious fractures and osteoporosis. So they want to know, what can I do about maintaining a healthy bone? So one thing is, as we go through menopause, we do need more protein in our diet. So we just don't need a ton of protein when we're in our 20s and 30s, unless we're bodybuilders. But otherwise, we sometimes overeat protein. But once we go through menopause, we do need more protein. But the best kind is a little bit of animal, like 3 ounces a day of a healthy sourced animal protein, and then a lot of plant-based proteins like beans and lentils, nuts and seeds, and whole grains like quinoa and millet and buckwheat, because those actually help. The other things that people don't realize is that dairy is not the best source of calcium, not at all, because dairy creates an acidic kind of a blood. And in order to alkalinize the blood and get it back to the proper pH, the bone calcium can actually be pulled out into the blood. So you actually can lose bone if you eat a high dairy type of a diet. And they've shown that there's been an increase in osteoporosis with the increase in dairy consumption. It's exactly the opposite of what people think. And the best way to maintain healthy calcium for your bones and getting the calcium into your bones, not just into your kidneys to form kidney stones, which is what's happening by the droves, actually, with all of the acid diets that people are consuming, is to have green leafy vegetables. So there's as much calcium in a cup of collard greens and dandelion greens and mustard greens, that kind of stuff that people aren't eating enough of, but also broccoli and such. But those greens that people aren't eating are so wonderful, and kale. And there's tons of calcium in dairy products, but it doesn't matter if it can't get into your bones. And if you have an acid type of blood, you will not be able to get the calcium from the blood into the bones, because that would make the blood even more acid, because calcium is like an antacid, like Tums. So you can't get rid of the calcium and put it into your bones if you have a lot of dairy. But that's totally the opposite when you have leafy greens in your diet, because they will actually leave the calcium from the blood, and it will go into your bones. So it's because you don't want to have alkaline blood either. You want to have it just the right pH. And this will help to make that happen. So every woman needs to know that she has to have more healthy proteins, a little bit of animal, and a lot from plant-based sources. That she needs, of course, to exercise and do resistance training, because that's what helps to create more muscle and bone, is the resistance training. I'm not against aerobic exercise at all, and that's very good for cardiovascular system. You should do all of it. But if I just focus on the bones, it's the resistance training. Also, high intensity, interval training can be great for bones. But I recommend that you do this with a professional so that you don't have injuries, because that becomes very problematic as we don't know what we're doing. So please have someone who knows what they're doing to instruct you on what to do to get the best bones and the best, safest exercise program for you. But and then adding as well targeted supplements like magnesium. 80% of people are magnesium deficient, and you need to have adequate magnesium, and then the trace minerals. So the easiest way is to take a mineral supplement, but magnesium you can also get with food. Some of my favorites are walnuts and pumpkin seeds. And when you're taking a vitamin D supplement, which virtually everybody needs and is essential for bone, of course, during the summer, we want to get some healthy sun exposure on our skin. And say we save up our vitamin D for the winter months that way without getting a burn. But we also need to usually take a vitamin D supplement. We want to get our levels up to like a 50, a 60, not like a 30. That is too low. So we need to also include, especially if you're over 50, a vitamin K2. Vitamin K2 is a vitamin made by the gut microbes. It's so amazing. Vitamin K1 comes from vegetables. It's all important. But the vitamin K2 is especially important for bones. It's also important for other things like the cardiovascular health. But many of us don't have the healthiest gut microbiome, especially after menopause, because hormones will sustain. And then when you have the lack of hormones, you will have an altered and a negative status of your gut microbiome. So you may not make enough vitamin K2. So all of these things are going to come into play. And then the other is to do everything to have an anti-inflammatory lifestyle, because osteoporosis is really a pro-inflammatory state, where you have inflammatory processes that are triggering the sort of gobbling up of the bone by the cells that gobble it up, called the osteoclasts, which are a specialized immune cell. So we want to start to do an anti-inflammatory lifestyle by getting adequate sleep, and then having mind-body medicine, controlling stress and all that cortisol, which is going to, high cortisol from stress is going to promote more bone loss. So, and the good thing is all this stuff that I just told you about having bone health is going to translate into metabolic health. So that is like, you also, everything is going to help your brain, your cardiovascular system. So it's not just a one thing. There's not one thing that does one thing when it comes to a nutrient or exercise or stress reduction. So even if I started talking about this is good for your bones, it's really good for everything.
That's awesome. I love it. So I really want women to go and get this book. This is amazing. So it's broken down in different sections, like what to expect with perimenopause as we talk, what to expect with early menopause, and what to expect with late menopause. And a lot of kind of what we talked about today, everything from falls, heart attacks, muscle loss. We talked about diabetes, hair thinning, heart palpitations. So this is just this is like a best, what are the resources that you can have at home, a guide. And it's almost like having Dr. Felice there with you. It's like, okay, what would she tell me about this? And she explains it, what happens, the why. And, you know, I ironically went to the wrinkles and skin texture changes and what you can do. And I mean, it's beautifully written. So thank you. I know a lot of ladies are going to appreciate this. This actually can be a great gift, Christmas present for some of the women. True. Or hey, new year's, start new year's, how to start the new year without being crabby and grumpy. There we go.
So it's menopause, 50 things you need to know by Dr. Felice Gerge. I am actually going to put the link also in the chat where people can go and find the book. And Dr. Felice, where can people find you? How can people work with you? I know that Carlina mentioned before that I believe you're doing remote visits as well. So can you tell us a little bit more for anyone who's interested?
Sure. Well, I'm still a very old-fashioned doctor. I work one-on-one with my patients, and I'm talking to you right now. I started telling you at the beginning that I'm in an exam room because I don't actually have a studio, but I have many exam rooms. So I see patients in my office, but also remotely through telemedicine. I can care for many things. I often will have to, depending on the state you live in, you may have to see me once a year, but I was saying like, it's a lovely place to come visit, but I can always start off with telemedicine and see if this is a right fit for you. And if you're in my local area, Southern California, I'm in Orange County, of course, then I would love for you to come and see me directly. And I care for women of all ages, and virtually any female issue is in my arena of conditions I will address.
And you're pretty active on Instagram too, with a lot of Instagram lives and information. So women need to follow you there as well. And your website one more time, doctor?
So it's integrativemgi.com. So my group is Integrative Medical Group of Irvine, and the website is integrativemgi.com. And I would love for people to follow me on Instagram, because most weeks I do put out a little program, and I would love to feel like I'm making a difference. Because really, at this point of my career, my main mission is making a difference for as many women as I can.
Absolutely. And what's your Instagram handle?
It's DR period. And you have to put that little period in there. DR period Felice Gerge.
And Dr. Gerge, what's the best place also to find your book?
Right now it's on Amazon. There's apparently a support chain problems in getting it published through different other sites. So it's right now solely on Amazon, but readily available there.
Beautiful. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Felice. It's been such an amazing time getting to learn from you once again. I took notes. I learned so much. I feel so confident right now.
Well, we want every woman to accept her beautiful femininity and not be afraid of menopause. Know it's either here or it's coming, but to be, like we said from the very beginning, preparedness is everything. Knowing that it's coming and that you have the tools to navigate all of the little twists and turns that you're going to be facing so that you can have a long, wonderful, healthy life. That's the goal.
Yes. Certainly. And also, Giovanna, I had a couple of questions which were already addressed. I just want to let Giovanna know, if you go back and you look at the recording, Dr. Felice gave all kinds of information throughout an hour. She literally is a fountain of information, and she shares so much with us. And so, thanks for hot flashes. What can you do about perimenopause, menopause, everything that you have a question about was already covered, and you are going to get so much value from listening to the replay and getting the answers to your questions. So I just want to address that. And Dr. Felice, thank you so much. It's been an honor having you with us again.
Yes, my pleasure. Till next time.
All right. We'll see you all. Thank you.
Happy holidays to everybody. Yes. We will see you next week.
All right. Bye.
Bye.